please join me in welcoming our host, UW Chancellor Becky Blank.
Thank you, Regina, for that very kind welcome. It is always a delight to host the Regents, and I'm delighted to have you all here for today and for tonight. It's always a good day when you meet Ohio State, and I'm hoping that's going to happen tonight, too. I want to talk a little bit about what's been happening here on campus. We are, as you all know, a world-class education and research institution. We have grown from an investment made by the state and the people of Wisconsin 168 years ago, and nourished over the last 168 years by the state and its citizens, by students and our faculty, and by our many, many alumni, not just in the state, but outside the state as well. We are today ranked as one of the top 25 universities in the world. That's a ranking that looks at both education and research. And one of only five U.S. public universities to be on that list. Remaining a top 25 institution is not a given. It only happens if you keep investing. Because I can promise you, our competition is investing. And today's talk is going to be about some of the investments we've made in the past and what they've produced. Some of the investments we're making today to be even better, and I need to say just a little bit about some of the investments that we haven't been able to make. So let me start by just saying a few things about some of the good things happening on campus. This is not moving.
There it goes.
All right. I actually have to go over another quarter. So it has been a record year for education. Some of you have seen a few slides like this in the education committee, but some of these bear repeating. We graduated more than 10,000 students this past year. We were one of the top five producers of PhD students, as well as large numbers of undergraduates. Our applications continue to rise. They're up nearly 8% last year over this year. And in a minute, I'm going to say something about what brings students here and why parents want their children to come here. The students, once they come to campus, are absolutely wonderful. To name just a few, Collins Higgins here to the left, won a Rhodes Scholar this last November, our third Rhodes in the last 5 years. We had two Truman Scholars, Phoenix Rice Johnson of Hawaii, and Elizabeth Dole of Verona, Wisconsin. The Truman Scholarship funds graduate study for people who are finishing their undergraduates, and to go work in areas of where leadership training is highly important. And we had this year the largest number of Fulbright-based scholars of any school in the country. That is a program that funds doctoral students to conduct research in strategically important areas of the world. Of course, it's not just our students who win major awards, our faculty as well. I could talk about this for the next hour, but I'm just going to mention a few. The Carl Spinley UNESCO Prize went to Professor Yoshi Koyoki, who is one of the major world-class researchers on microbiology and on the transmission of viral infections. The Baldwin Prize. Professor Chris Kittinger and his team invented a way to quickly and efficiently create some new that opens the door to all sorts of new products, including some of Wisconsin's favorite fermented foods, beer and wine. But this is also highly important for the breakdown of plants into biofuels. So there are many, many applications of this. Out of all of this, we are truly an engine of economic growth in the state. We add $15 billion annually to the Wisconsin economy. We foster the creation of more than 300 startup companies, some of them now among the biggest companies in the state, some of them among the fastest growing companies in the state. And for every dollar that we receive from the state, we actually generate $24 in economic activity. That is a great return on investment, and I would dare say probably the best return on investment among any state agencies. Of course, it's not just about research and education. We also have fun at Madison, and one of the ways in which we have fun is through our athletics program. You're going to hear more about this from Barry a little later this afternoon. You all know that we've won bowl games the last 2 years against Auburn and against USC this year, but you may not know that our football team was actually ranked number one in its academic performance over every other Division I team in the country. We beat up you, we beat up you. But you may not know that 16 of our 23 teams went on to postseason play. And I'm very proud of their performance on and off the field. If you haven't picked up this news yesterday, we have seen in that group. The only group in our society over the last 25 years that has experienced significant wage growth are those with four-year college degrees or more. And that is the reason why all of our institutions are so important to this state, because that in part is the future of this state. Now I'm going to show you one more graph, which is, by people told me to take it out, but I can't resist as an economist because I find it so interesting. I break this down now between men and women. Men are the red, women are the blue. And one of the things that I find so striking here is the enormous success of higher education for women. In particular, women have flooded into higher education over the last 25 years. You'd think that might actually drive their returns down, but their returns continue to be higher than those of men. I suspect at almost all our institutions, we are now more than 50% women, because more women are in higher ed than men. And so it raises a lot of interesting questions about what we need to be doing to get more people of both genders and of all types into higher education. But, you know, that's the reason we're working on this. So let me show you how we provide a quality education at UW-Madison and some of the statistics we have. And again, a few of you have seen these, but I always think they're worth repeating. In order to get that four-year degree, you have to come and you have to stay. So this is our retention rates. from freshman to sophomore year. We're currently at just about 96% retention rate. That competes with any other school in the country, big, little, private, public. But even better news, that gap between all students and our targeted minority students has closed almost entirely in retention rates. And we worked hard at that, and I feel very proud of that, and we need to keep that, that success going on. If you move from retention rates to graduation rates, again, you not just have to stay in your sophomore year, you have to graduate. The six-year graduation rate, which is what is typically used here, gives us an 85% graduation rate. Now, this is among students who start at UW-Madison. It doesn't count transfers in, it doesn't count transfers out, it doesn't count people who pause and go into the military and then come back and take longer than 6 years to graduate. And here, too, you see a closing gap with our targeted minority students, but far from closed. And clearly, we've got an ongoing agenda, both to continue to raise these numbers and to narrow that gap. On the other hand, I will note that we were named this past, just a few months ago, actually, in the DC Based Education Trust as one of the top 15 schools in the nation in terms of the work we've done to shrink that graduation gap, and we clearly just got to keep working at that. Of course, education isn't just about what happens inside the classroom and how much time it takes you. It's also about what happens outside the classroom, particularly if you're a major residential college. Why is this not moving? Yeah, thank you. And I'm also very proud of what we're doing outside the classroom. Internships. Lots of discussion about the need for students to have internships. Two-thirds of our current seniors report they have held an internship or participated in some form of career experience off campus as part of their education. We can continue to increase that number, but we're doing well on that front. Studying abroad, we are the top school in the Big Ten for the percentage of students from our campus who go overseas with some form of an overseas educational experience. I'm proud of that, but still only about 28-29% of our students, and we need to keep bumping that up, particularly in a world of rapidly growing global demand. But we're, again, doing as well, if not better, than many of our peers. And of course, even if you don't go to a business and you don't go overseas, simply getting out into the community is another way to integrate your education with what else you're learning in your life. This past year, we had 4,500 students participating in public service, either as part of their classes or as part of our Badger Volunteers program. They're helping the elderly, tutoring at schools, fixing bicycles, you see a picture of that for kids, helping keep the lakes clean, and hopefully not only contributing to the community, but learning something at the same time. So with all of this, I love this next chart. This is the U.S. schools that are ranked in the top 25. And this shows you what their tuition rates are, okay? And it won't surprise you that these are all privates. Until you get down here, you get Michigan, San Diego, Berkeley, UCLA, and Madison. And, you know, we're the best bargain in the world, pretty much, if you look at this, among the U.S. schools. And then I show you the resident tuition, and even for residents, you can come here and get an absolutely top quality education at a lower cost than almost anywhere. And it won't surprise you that I think at least for the non-residents, we may be a little bit too good of a deal, but we'll continue to come back and talk about that. In addition, of course, to all these other things, one of the very important aspects of education is the community that you live in. And diversity and inclusiveness has been very much on everyone's agenda and part of the public conversation. It's big news across the nation, and we've had some very active students concerned and involved in this for years, as well as faculty and staff. You care about diversity for all sorts of reasons. You can talk about the competitive advantages, you can talk about the educational advantages, but at the end of the day, making sure that every student, regardless of where they come from, has access to these top public universities is simply the right thing to do. It's part of our mission, and that is why we need to care about this. We've been in the midst of implementing our new framework for diversity, which a large group of faculty, staff, students, community members put together 2 years ago, and you know, are in the midst of trying to see what we can do and how much further we can push. This is a process. You are never going to get to where you want to be and say, now we're done. There's always more that needs to be done on this front. We have made some progress. Among students of color, We've gone from 10% to 15% in the last 10 years. If I were looking just at underrepresented targeted minorities, those numbers would be 8% to 10%. Among first-generation students, I don't have 2005 data, but right now just about 20% of our undergraduates are first-gen. And among faculty of color, we've gone from 15% to 19%. On the one hand, in recent hiring classes of faculty, we've done really well. 25% of our new hires last year were faculty of color. But I will also tell you, a disproportionate share of our departing faculty are faculty of color, because it is an incredibly competitive market out there with these concerns for diversity among really top faculty who also happen to be faculty of color. So, you know, continuing to push on that front and making sure we're gaining and not losing as much as we gain with every class is really important. I want to end this section by talking a little bit about student debt, okay? Because there's a lot of discussion of student debt, and I will say that not all of it, in my opinion, is accurate. So I already showed you the value of a four-year college education. There's a lot of economics research that tries to ask, what's the net economic gain out of 4 years of college? And a lot of different ways to do this, some right, some wrong, some things that you can argue about, but all of these studies, by and large, show that the gain from 4 years of college versus not getting that degree is somewhere between $500,000 and $1 million. So if I asked you, would you borrow $25,000 today in order to make $500,000 to $1 million sometime over the next 30 to 40 years? I hope every one of you would say yes to that. That's actually a pretty good deal. And it does indicate the fact that borrowing for some students in many cases makes some sense. The question is, how much do you borrow? And can, you know, and how do you pay it back, and what are the circumstances and the interest rates, and, you know, can you carry the debt load? And there's no question that some number of students, including students on our campus, borrow way too much, right? And you've got to worry about that. But debt is growing, and you've all noticed that, and that in some ways isn't a surprise, because there are only three ways you pay for college. Either you or your family pays, you or your family borrows and pays out of future income, or someone else pays for you. Now, someone else pays for you is usually public money, right? We know that's been going down. You and your family pays, we know in the state of Wisconsin and many other parts of this country, family incomes have been stagnant. So that's made it harder for them to pay as costs continue to increase in higher education. So it's not surprising that borrowing, therefore, is going up, right? And the question is always, is this worth it or is it not? So let me show you what borrowing at Madison looks like. Comment number one. Over half of our students have no debt upon graduation. All right, that's a number that is too little talked about. Nationwide, it's about a third, okay? Comment two, among those who do hold debt, we're at about the average. Median debt is $26,900. Average debt is $28,700. It's $28,900 for the country. All right, now, oftentimes people talk about those $26,000, $28,000 numbers as if every student who left school had that level of debt. That is the level of debt only among those who hold debt, all right? So half of our students hold no debt. So you've got to understand what those numbers mean. Furthermore, among our students, they are very good at repaying that debt, which does suggest when they get out of college, they've borrowed an amount and are getting into jobs that make it pretty straightforward for them to repay that debt and are not getting themselves in trouble. Our default rates are amazingly low compared to the national default rates. And all of that suggests to me not that we don't have some students who borrow too much and we don't have to worry about this issue, but that for many of our students, perhaps the majority of our students, you know, borrowing as one component of their education is not necessarily a bad thing as long as they can repay it, as long as it doesn't put them in hock in a way that really gets them into financial trouble after they graduate. Understanding the whole set of numbers here really matters, okay? The amount of debt the students hold is closely linked with a number of things. It's linked with how fast you graduate. High debts tend to grow if you stay more than 4 years, so it's one reason why those graduation rates and getting people through in 4 years is really important. It's also closely linked with financial aid. And here I show you our financial aid dollars. The blue are federal dollars, the yellow are state dollars, and the red are the dollars we put in out of our own tuition and other institutional funds. It's largely tuition funds and gift funds. Federal dollars have been pretty flat. They jumped up in the run, to, you know, with the ARA, actually, with the recession package. But they've been flat since, even declined a little. State dollars have been flat for, what, 7, 8 years right now. And
You know, there's a part of me, if you're a federal or state government official, and you say, I'm really worried about student debt, I would look back at you and say, so, you know, what are you doing about this? And yes, part of that's about rates, part of that's about other things, but part of that is about making financial aid available to students, okay? We have put a lot of money in this, and one reason our debt numbers look as good as they do is we put institutional funds in. Not nearly enough. We still have too many students to, and we don't fill the full need gap. But, you know, we're sure doing better than if we hadn't made those sorts of commitments. What else are we doing to keep debt down and debt handleable among our students? Student scholarships is a key priority in the fundraising campaign we're in the midst of. As I noted, we're making real efforts to increase graduation rates and reduce time to graduation, and we're making steady progress on that. And then we've also launched a financial education program on campus run through the School of Human Ecology. We're offering a course called Financial Life Skills, which covers a variety of information students are going to need as they go out into the world to successfully manage their finances, from renting to buying a car, getting insurance to a home. The enrollment has more than doubled, and we just launched this a year ago. Over these semesters, we now have 4 sections we're offering. They all have waiting lists, and we're planning to expand this further and really encouraging as many students as possible to consider taking this. It's a low-credit course, but one that I think is an important addition to their education. So let me segue out of education and what we're doing. It wouldn't be a presentation at the University of Wisconsin-Madison if I didn't talk about budgets, right? any private sector business owner is going to tell you that staying on the top in terms of quality and reputation requires continual investment because your competition is not standing still. And I'd say higher education these days is competitive not just at the national level, but at the international level. If you look at what some other countries are doing with their higher education programs. We've had a series of difficult years in terms of budget here at the University of Wisconsin and all of the different schools. And that's particularly problematic because our competitors are moving forward and receiving new investments, and we've had much more difficulty achieving that. So let me show you, this is 2010 through 2015, and this does not include the last round of budget cuts. We don't have all the state data for that. So if you put the last round of budget cuts, where we were one of two of the most highly cut, almost all of the states went up, this would look much worse. But as you can see, even in this, we're really at the bottom in terms of one of the few states that's showing declines in investment in higher education. Now, what's particularly important to note is that this is just the publics, right? If I had anything here about the privates, which are equally our competitors at UW-Madison, this would look even worse. So, you know, the need to find dollars to invest in high demand programs, dollars to make sure our undergraduate education programs are what they should be, to keep moving towards closing that gap between our different groups of students, pushing graduation rates down, all of that requires good programs, good leadership, good staff and faculty on the ground, but it also does require some money. It is not costless. If you look at our budget landscape, I'm not going to show you this in percentages, I'm showing you this in inflation-adjusted dollars, okay? The red line, which in, what is that, 1974, is by far our largest source of dollars, is state funding. By 2016, it is at the bottom, and the smallest share of dollars coming from any of our major sources. The blue line is federal dollars, and that all goes to research. In some sense, that's a little separable. You can't use those dollars for anything except what they're given to you for. And the federal research budget, particularly in the 90s, early 2000s, grew substantially, and we've been very successful at getting some of those dollars. The green line is gifts and grants. That has grown steadily. The auxiliaries are purple. That's the money in and money out programs that self-fund themselves, like our dorms. And I think that's everything, yeah. So, you know, it gives you a sense of, you know, we are really changing. And we're changing in a way, and I've said this to a number of groups, we are no longer a public research institution. We're a quasi-public research institution or a quasi-private research institution. And, you know, the issue is how do you manage all of these different revenue streams? And thinking about ourselves solely as a public institution does not recognize the growth in a variety of other revenue sources that are coming forward, and that's the way we need to be thinking moving forward. We, as of July 1st, had an $86 million deficit that we had to face, and let me talk a little bit about how we filled that. on the vast majority, 60% of it, was closed through budget cuts. We've cut $34 million out of our operations across the university. This past year, we're going to cut another $16 million off the next year. We prioritized trying to cut administrative units a little bit more highly than educational units. We've given differential cuts to different programs in terms of our own prioritization, but at the end of the day, you can't take these sort of cuts without affecting every single unit across campus. And of course, for many of our units, the vast majority, 85-90% of their expenses are people. So what you're affecting here, particularly in the education units, as well as some of the administrative units, is people. A few examples, the College of Letters and Science is running down 48 faculty and 44 staff positions. That has a real effect on what classes are offered and the size of those classes. The College of Engineering, because of its growth and demand, was expanding its advisors. It's not able to do that with some of the budget cuts. CALS, as some of you have read about, is reducing some of its outreach programs. And this is one of those things that nobody cares about but really matters. We're now maintaining every building at what's called Tier 3. That means we're basically doing as little cleaning as maintenance as possible. And you know, that doesn't show up much in the next 6 months. But I promise you, 3 years, 5 years, 10 years down the road, we keep maintenance at Tier 3. We will be facing major deterioration in our buildings at a much higher level than if we were maintaining them at the level we should. That's just a huge expense you're pushing off, you know, somewhere down the road to the next Board of Regents and the next set of chancellors, and that's not a good idea either. One of the things that related to that I'm particularly concerned about is up until this past year, all of the budgets gave us two tranches of money. It gave us a certain amount of maintenance dollars. This is in our capital funds. And then on top of that, they considered whether they're going to give us money for building. And this all comes out of the borrowing part of the budget. This is not part of the basic GPR. This year, as you know, we got very little money for buildings. My campus is one of the only that got anything, which I deeply appreciate. But most importantly, none of us sitting around this table got any money for maintenance. So I'm now at a point when the next steam pipe breaks, or the next thing, you know, breaks off that it has to get fixed, that money's coming out of my educational dollars because I have zero state money for maintenance. I have 430 buildings. I don't know what the total number is across campus, but that's just irresponsible in terms of support for state buildings and state institutions, and I do hope that's going to change in the next budget. The remaining of the gap, that's how we closed 60%. The remainder of the gap, almost all of it is closed through the tuition flexibility that you gave us this last October to raise some of our professional school and out-of-state tuition, which was long overdue. There's just sort of a little bit, 5% or so, that we're closing through some efficiencies and through the non-residential flexibilities you gave us a few months ago. So I thank you for those flexibilities, but I've got to emphasize the following bottom line. None of the increases in revenues that we were able to get out of this have gone for investments. They've all gone to fill the budget gap. So I've not been able to use any of this to do the type of investments and program that I need to be doing in order to maintain this university at the level of quality that needs to be maintained. And again, that doesn't show up this year. It may not even show up next year, but over time, that will start to show up. Now, in addition to the budget, of course, you know, we've had a big tenure debate. And they've generated a lot of national and international publicity, which has really come back, and I think it's really hurt us particularly because UW-Madison is the one that everyone looked at and said, you know, look at what's happening to them. That uncertainty has affected morale, and it's created real recruitment problems for us. This is the sort of headlines that we've seen that everyone read. Now, half of those headlines are wrong, right? Or they're simply misinformed. But this is what everyone around the country read. So perhaps it's not a surprise that they all decided this was a great time to recruit the University of Wisconsin-Madison's best faculty. And we've had a whole series of recruitment challenges. We started getting recruitment offers the middle of the summer. We got a huge number in September. This never happens. You don't start seeing recruitment offers until, you know, November or December or even later in the year. The question that I and the deans and the department chairs have been trying to answer to people, and people are asking this very directly, you know, is the University of Wisconsin going to remain a top university, or do I need to go elsewhere? Because our faculty, by and large, love it here, want to stay, but they do care about being at a top quality place. And obviously, for a long time, the answer to that has been yes, and we need to keep it yes, right? But there are real worries amongst the faculty about these budget cuts, about the tenure changes, about some of the other controversial legislative proposals, such as the fetal tissue bill that you all know about. So these are the sorts of institutions that have made offers to our faculty. It's a top group of private and public schools. And, you know, in the last 6 months, the College of Letters and Sciences School of Education have doubled in these last 6 months, the first half of the year, doubled the number of cases they handled all of last year. The median outside offer coming in is 30% higher. We've seen one or two offers that were 100% over their current salary. You know, and, you know, this means that we're spending a lot of money on retention. That is important. We need to spend that money. But it, as I'll say in a moment, it's not cheap. So what are we doing about this? We have explicitly gone into a reputation recovery mode and put together a strategy of what we need to do to get past the reputational issues that these headlines, right or wrong, have put on us. And the first thing we're doing is pushing out as many great stories about Wisconsin as we can. And, you know, that's easy to do. We've always got great stories. And I think our communications people have been quite successful at that. Most importantly, we want to make it clear that Wisconsin is not open for rating. So out of those who have made a decision, and a majority of the people who've received offers over this fall have decided what's happening, 85% of them are staying. That is a wonderful retention rate. It is above what I expected. It's above our average retention rate. I think it reflects both the really serious effort we've made at retention, but it also reflects the fact that people really do want to stay if they have the right arguments to stay. But there are a lot of offers that are still open. There are more offers that are going to come in. We're not past this yet. Altogether, it's cost me $8 million in the last 6 months to receive that type of success. Now, that's both salary increases as well as all of the one-time funds you give faculty, matching outside offers around additional research funds or graduate assistantships or equipment. And, you know, this is going to cost more. I can't afford not to do this. This is the reputation of the university, but add that to my deficit. In addition to keeping people, telling people they can't rate us, a number of us in leadership are explicitly trying to get around the state. I've been out about once a month, and this is we had a great trip out to the Cranberry Bogs. It's Kate Vandenbosch, who's the dean of Cal's, and I got to go out waiting in the bogs, and you know, just trying to get out there and talk about the university and what it's doing. And then we're doing something we've never done before in conjunction with the foundation. As you all know, we launched a major fundraising campaign this fall, and the foundation is funding an advertising campaign. And I suspect many of you have seen some of our billboards and ads. We're doing some ads in places like the Chronicle of Higher Education, as well as some billboards in key places around the state. Someone noted, you know, strange thing, I saw a UW billboard in San Diego during the bowl game. And I said, yeah, that was really strange, wasn't it? You know, we were really trying to think, where and how do we need to do this effectively? Okay. You know, I think we're at a pretty good place. We have closed our we will have closed the deficit by the time we're done with all of this. I think we've done a pretty good job of responding to the challenges that we were given. And I'm pretty cautiously optimistic we're going to move forward and put all of this behind us. And I know you're going to be dealing with some of the 10-year resolutions. And the sooner we can get behind that and feel like we've moved forward on that front, the happier I'll be. And I really appreciate all the work that has been done on that, both on the campuses as well as among the regions. But at the end of the day, it has to be about investment. We have to be talking about what we're doing to move forward. And I want to end this by talking very briefly about two investments that we are making that I think are highly important. The first one is to try to create a much more extensive summer term. The second one is LMS's efforts at a new career initiative. So let me take just 5 minutes and then turn it over to Carl for the last few minutes. We were one of the first places in the nation to establish a summer school 131 years ago. But we haven't been overly creative about that recently and haven't done much to think about what should summer semester look like. So what we're going to do is think seriously about that. And this is a twofer. Most importantly, by expanding our summer offerings, we can provide a much better education to our students. We can give them options they need to have. I'll say more about that in a minute. But of course, it also is an increased revenue stream. And in fact, it is the cheapest increased revenue stream to simply run 12 months out of the year rather than running 9 months out of the year. We've got the facilities, we've got the faculty and teachers, we know how to handle students in traditional classes. This one is a no-brainer. So why a summer term? Well, first of all, not many students actually have to go home and take in the harvest anymore. You know, the world is running 24/7. Our universities ought to be running around the year as well. A trimester system just makes more sense in many ways than a semester system with a large summer break. Opportunity costs, as I've already mentioned, it's a much better use of our $15 million square feet of instructional space to use it year-round than to use it only 9 months out of the year. This will help us meet the demand for high-demand classes. We do have classes with waiting lists. We can't fill all those classes, you know, offer that many more classes during the regular two semesters, but we can offer them in the summer. And tell students, if you're changing majors, if you need to take another art chem class or some such thing, come do it in the summer. You know, work over part of the summer, stay here, fill out your schedule, get yourself on track so you graduate in 4 years. We also can use the summer to expand our non-traditional courses, and in many ways the summer is the best semester to do that, whether these are short courses, professional certificate courses, non-degree university experiences, all sorts of things that generate additional revenues and play to our educational reputation and strength, and bring many more students to this campus for parts of their education. So, you know, the non-traditional students are important. Expands our reputation, the more people we bring to Madison, and I think most importantly, it plays off one of our best comparative advantages. No place is more beautiful than Madison in the summer. And the fact that we send everyone home doesn't make any sense. All right. Three audiences. Our traditional undergraduates, we want some of them who, when it's valuable to them to come take summer courses, maybe you take the spring off for an internship or to go overseas and then come take classes in the summer. Our traditional students, undergraduates from elsewhere, that includes high school students, as Ray has talked about, who might want to get a jump on some college credits, or students who have to go take art chem, but they happen to be at Dartmouth and they're coming home for the summer, let them take it here, and then the non-traditional students who we can bring in for shorter periods of time through special educational experiences. The challenges are very real. We are offering at least 100 new classes this summer. Many of them are those high-demand classes we, quite honestly, in my opinion, should have been offering all along. But, you know, we do have to get the departments putting together the right curriculum, incentivizing them to participate. Most importantly, we've got to market this, or no one will show up, right? You know, let them know what we're doing and why they need to come. We need to figure out how we handle students year-round, how we handle our facilities year-round. All of that is important. The long-term vision here is really to think about summer semester like any other semester. I want to think that faculty could teach in the summer and go do their research in the fall and trade off summer versus fall classes. As it turns out, I can't do that right now because of a variety of restrictions on how we pay faculty. I have to pay faculty only as an overage in the summer. It can't be a substitute. So I'm going to be coming back to you and coming back to the system and talking about some of the restrictions that are keeping us from making this a full summer semester. And I hope over the next several years we can make some changes that will do that. Similarly, we want students to think about when they start in school. Maybe it's better for them to start in June and not wait until this summer, what semesters they might take off, or whether they actually want to go through school year-round and graduate a little bit sooner. So we're working with the faculty to accomplish this. This clearly is going to require a lot of work on the part of our faculty governance committees as to how we move this forward and what we do. It is going to take a lot of good staff vision. I really want to thank Dean Jeff Russell of Continuing Studies, who's doing a lot of the work on this. But I'm very excited about this. It's one of the new things that we're investing in that's going to make us a better university and a better funded university at the same time. And now I'm handing things over to Dean Scholes. He's going to give you just a few minutes on the LMS Career Initiative, another new investment.
Thank you very much, Chancellor Blank. I'm honored to talk to you today about an initiative intended to help our students into the world and make a good living and lead a good life. And I'm not just talking about knowledge of literary analysis or understanding of chemistry or the laws of physics or an appreciation of markets and the way the economy works. But don't get me wrong, I think all of these are important and all of these are reasons that students will come to the College of Letters and Science at UW-Madison. But today I'm talking about a different set of skills. These are the foundational skills for the liberal arts degree, and they are skills that our students often don't know that they possess. The ability to write well, to present with confidence, to communicate, to analyze and solve problems, to think critically. These are the skills that employer survey after employer survey says are sorely needed in the workplace. And my students in the College of Letters and Science have these skills that employers want, but many of them don't know how to talk about the value of their degrees to employers, or even to the alumni who might help them. They don't know how to build networks or to search effectively for internships and jobs. These gaps are ones that we need to bridge, and out of this observation comes the Letters and Science Career Initiative. To build a strong program for the future, we need to first understand where our Letters and Science alumni are today. Where do they excel? Where do they experience challenges? We need to know this to be accountable to our students, to their parents, and to all of our stakeholders. And so to establish a baseline for our initiative, we surveyed, with the generous financial support provided by Chancellor Blank, two groups of alumni, 1 year after graduation and alums 8 to 10 years after graduation. We were very pleased to see how our graduates are doing. Letters and Science students are getting jobs, and they are getting jobs that use their degrees. They are on their way, the return on their investment is good, and earnings growth is quite rapid. 70% of respondents said their Letters and Science academic preparation gave them an advantage at their workplace relative to their workplace peers. And more than 90% of respondents would choose to attend UW-Madison again. We're proud of these results, but we also have work to do. From our data, we also learned graduates said they don't feel they were prepared early enough in their college experience for the world of work. Graduates thought that our existing career services, career-related activity, could use some improvement. And many of our students yearn for more mentorships. Periodic graduation surveys will be one of the ways that we will be able to assess how we are doing. This survey provides a baseline. With the Letters and Science Career Initiative, then, we're going to launch our students higher and sooner. And we're going to do this relying almost exclusively on alumni and corporate support. The Chancellor already talked about the impact of budget cuts. In my college alone, we're navigating a $7.4 million budget cut with a near total hiring freeze. At the same time, I think we can change lives for our students we serve and become a role model for other great public research universities. Our success is particularly critical for first-generation college students and students from historically underrepresented groups. And I'm impatient. I don't want to wait to tackle this work. Fortunately, our friends and supporters share our passion and our commitment, and they have generously funded our work to date. I believe if we deliver, they are committed to our future as well. Along with the dedicated faculty and staff, then, we have three partners for the Letters and Science Career Initiative: students, alumni, employers. I want to touch on each briefly. We reach students through a new course called Taking Initiative that's taught by an outstanding professor, where students reflect on their skills, define their aspirations, and assess their strengths. Career advisors attend every session and are a direct resource to help students plan to use their time on campus as effectively as possible. Talented alumni from different professions Skype in to speak with students, sharing valuable advice and knowledge about their industries and careers. Course evaluations that you see on the slide tell us that this has been a game changer for our students. It's easy for people in our position to think that resumes and networking and internships and take those for granted, thinking that every student knows about them. But many, many do not. And so we are teaching skills that matter. To date, we've reached about 650 students through this course, and we've just started our third semester. We also reach students in several other ways. We launched Career Kickstart this fall in the Auburn Residence Hall. In the photo here, you'll see Jim St. Vincent, the Vice President of Human Resources at American Family Insurance, speaking with a group of LMS students at the fall opening. Career Kickstart is a one-of-a-kind immersive residential learning community for 600 sophomores, providing on-site academic and career advising, exclusive opportunities to interact with alumni mentors and employers, and special sections of our Taking Initiative course. This residence hall filled up twice as fast as it did in previous years when there was no career theme. both Taking Initiative and Career Kickstarter, helping to increase student participation in all of our career preparation activities. And our departments are following suit. About 80% of the departments in my college now have added a new career resource for their undergraduates. Our extraordinary loyal alums will help us change the world. Now, who's better to spark students' imaginations about career possibilities than successful alums? Who better to help our students create professional networks? Who better to inspire and motivate our students to think strategically about their future and everything they can do in the world? We're just getting started, but from financing the Career Initiative to class presentations and panels to a variety of networking events, our alums have stepped up to help students. Within the first year of this project, we have over 300 alumni participate. We've created a great video series, Badger to Badger, Steps That Matter, in which LNS alums share their career stories and advice for students. In one video, Ann Kinney, who's the Director of Space Exploration for NASA's Goddard Flight Center, she describes her job as Director of the Universe, tells aspiring astronomers and astrophysicists why their literature courses will be critical to developing communication skills, which are imperative to building trust in her industry. Soon, working with the Wisconsin Alumni Association, we will launch Badger Bridge, an online platform to match students with alumni mentors across the globe who are especially well-positioned to help them. Meanwhile, we're creating opportunities for students to meet with and interview alumni or shadow them at their workplace. We're building out internship opportunities and networking events. We are developing partnerships with Wisconsin and national employers. Rather than simply helping them with rudimentary recruiting activities, we seek active, reciprocal relationships. We want employers to inform us about the skills they need and whether our students are making the cut. And if our students lack essential career preparation, we, along with our employer partners, will step up and help prepare these students. In our first year, American Family Insurance, Covance, Qualtrics, and Epic Systems have sponsored the Letters in Science Career Initiative for its projects. Through employer partnerships, we will work to connect HR managers and recruiters directly with students early and often. Since commencing this component last summer, we've received at least a dozen inquiries into partnership opportunities, and we haven't advertised it yet. Through intentional outreach and partnerships, we plan to vastly increase the number of employer-to-student contacts, resulting in more opportunities for our graduates. And we aspire to be the go-to talent acquisition source for Wisconsin employers and beyond. So in closing, I love this graphic we just projected. This illustration is the work of an LNS grad, Dylan Moriarty, a geography and math major, who's finding great success as a map maker and illustrator for companies and nonprofits, including his alma mater. When UW-Madison students enter the Wisconsin workforce fully prepared to achieve and lead, the state economy gains and grows. The same is true for the nation and the world. We have a great start to fulfilling our goals. Our peers are taking notice. So my arts and science dean peer from Michigan led a group here this summer. An alumni couple from Connecticut is fundraiser and an internships coordinator to study the Letters in Science Career Initiative. Michigan doesn't come to Wisconsin very often to study what we're doing, although they should come more frequently, I think. Similarly, Illinois and Ohio State have expressed interest. In the coming years, we're going to refine our comprehensive internships program to reach thousands of students, continue to increase employer relationships and partnerships, and expand alumni participation from a few hundred to thousands to tens of thousands with Badger Bridge. We have our work cut out for us, but we'll call upon the strength of all members of our community, faculty, staff, employer partners, and our energetic and well-connected alumni to achieve these goals. We are on a way to set a new standard for career preparation among the nation's great public research universities. I'm honored to be given the chance to tell you about it.
We're open to questions.
Thank you, Chancellor Blank, and thank you, Dean Schultz. There are many reasons people across the nation and even around the world look to Wisconsin with respect and even envy for the success of its students and its faculty. And it's important that we also understand what the challenges are that you face in these coming years. I would believe that it's equally important that we know how you're meeting those challenges, and I would venture to say that this will ultimately be yet another way that people around the country and around the world will look to you with respect and envy. Now, are there questions from, or comments from the Regents? Yes.
Thank you. Chairman, I was just interested a little bit in your thoughts about another form of diversity, economic diversity on the campus, and how you feel that's going. I mean, there was, I saw several months ago the New York Times does a college access index, and it measures universities across the country in regards to Pell Grants and affordability, and in particular, access to low and moderate income students and their families. And I think Madison, in that at least index, however good or flawed it may be, it was, I think, 116th or something. Could you just talk about where you see that? What are some of the key obstacles keeping potentially the campus from maybe having additional or greater economic diversity, and what you feel on road forward is in that regard?
Yeah, let me mention two things. I mean, the first is that I think the whole set of diversity initiatives trying to create a more inclusive community are important. Because students from low-income backgrounds, whether they come from small communities in northern Wisconsin or whether they come from the middle of, you know, very poor urban neighborhoods, find often a university someplace that they're not very familiar with. It's like going to a foreign land. So trying to create a campus which is welcoming and inclusive of students of all types is, I think, a very important piece of this. And the fact that we are a state that is a majority European background, white faces, has a certain look to it that sometimes makes us more off-putting for students who are low-income, who are looking, really excited about college and want to try to get somewhere. But secondly, and I think probably most importantly, this is one where the money really is important. You've got to have the funds to fill out the full set of need. We've got a lot of competitor schools. When you have a Pell Grant student, they just, make sure they cover all the other needs for those students. We don't have those resources. We put it together with a mix of some scholarships, some work study, and some debt. And if you have a choice between going someplace where you don't have to take on debt or where you do, particularly if you're a low-income student, you probably aren't going to come to us. So the need for us to continue to expand those need-based scholarships is just deeply important if we're going to make further progress on the economic access issue.
Thank you. Other questions? Other comments? Well, thank you very much.
Okay.
We appreciate the presentation.